Welcome students to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. K.S. Nagaraja of Deccan College Pune, teaching the course of Historical Linguistics. Today we will look at the module Indo-Aryan Languages, but here we take the second one, Middle Indo-Aryan, into consideration. In the previous module, we looked at Old Indo-Aryan Languages. One thing about Old Indo-Aryan was that the language as such was very complex. It is traditionally known as highly inflectional language with three numbers, three genders, 8K suffixes with agreement features, complex morphology and complex syntax as well. So, in the Middle Indo-Aryan, we see some sort of simplification of the language. In fact, in Old Indo-Aryan, particularly in the Vedic, the Rig Veda particularly, it was the accent was phonemic in nature, that is non-predictable. But by the time we go to classical Sanskrit, the accent had become predictable, and that means it had lost its phonemic status. So the type of simplifications which we could see in the later Old Indo-Aryan, they become much more prominent in Middle Indo-Aryan, starting with Pali, the earliest Buddhist canons, and other Prakrits. So, in this particular module, we look at the developments of Middle Indo-Aryan, taking the Old Indo-Aryan stage as a reference point. The earliest Middle Indo-Aryan, we normally trace it to Pali language. The Buddhist canons are encoded in that version. In fact, belonging to what is known as Theravada Buddhism, that is the earliest one. And then the other versions of Prakrit we see are developing very fast. In fact, the Prakrits, the very word Prakrita is natural or what is found in the common man. So from there we get Prakrits. So Prakrits as different from Sanskrit. Sanskrit is supposed to be refined or codified, whereas Prakrit means something which is natural, found in the nature as it were. That means spoken by the common masses. So Buddha, obviously, for the purpose of reaching the common man, preferred that variety so that understanding would be easier. Similarly, when the Buddhist inscriptions were created, that means Ashoka got the inscriptions made, they were all in Prakrits. In fact, they went to the extent of using Prakrits of the local areas for all their inscriptions. Therefore, the inscriptions found across India show differences based on the variety used. It's because of this reason. That means at that time itself, there were many differences in Prakrit, like Ardhamagadhi, Maharashtri, Saurasani, or some of the famous Prakrits. In fact, Maharashtri is considered to be the best to be used in literature par excellence. And the latest form of development of Middle Indo-Aryan is normally called Apabhramsha. The very word Apabhramsha means corrupted one. Interestingly though, there are some literary creations in Apabhramsha as well, belonging to 6th century AD. An inscription of King Dharasena II of Vallabhi, this particular Apabhramsha is used. The king praises his father as being adept in Sanskrit, Prakrit and Apabhramsha compositions. That shows that the three were treated as different from each other. Moreover, in the fourth act of Kalidasa's drama, the Vikramasheya, there are verses in Apabhramsha variety. So that shows that Apabhramsha, though means corrupted, had literary status as well. And the Apabhramshas gradually lead to newer versions across the country, and the modern Indo-Aryan languages emerge from these Apabhramshas. Some of these dialects showed considerable literary production. The Sravakachar of Devasena, dated to 930s, is now considered to be the first Hindi work. The Sanskrit word Prakrita, whence the term Prakrit, is a derivative from Prakriti, original nature. Grammarians of the Prakrits generally consider the original from which they derive to be the Sanskrit language, as described by grammarians going back to Panini. Most modern scholars consider Prakrita to refer to the natural languages, the vernaculars, as opposed to Sanskrit, the polished language of literature and the educated class or the Shishta. There is also linguistic evidence to support this view. Several forms in the Prakrits are found in Vedic but not in classical Sanskrit. As classical Sanskrit is not directly derivable from any single Vedic dialect, so the Prakrits cannot be said to derive directly from classical Sanskrit. The most archaic literary Prakrit is Pali, the language of the Buddhist canons belonging to probably 5th century BC, and of the later stories and commentaries of Theravada Buddhism. Pali represents essentially a Western Middle Indo-Aryan dialect, though there are sufficient Easternisms in the canon to have led some scholars to the view that the canon as it exists today is a recast of an original in an Eastern dialect. To the Buddhist literature also belongs the Gandhari Dhammapada, the only literary text written in a dialect of the Northwest. The Niya documents, official documents written in Prakrit dating from the 3rd century AD, also belong to the Northwest. The earliest inscriptional Middle Indo-Aryan is that of the Ashokan inscriptions belonging to 3rd century BC. These are more or less full translations from original edicts issued in the language of the East from the capital Pataliputra in Magadha or modern Patna in Bihar into the languages of the areas of Ashoka's kingdom. There are other Prakrit inscriptions up to the 4th century AD, and Sanskrit was not used inscriptionally until the 1st centuries AD. Literary Prakrits, other than Pali, were also used in independent works and in dramas along with Sanskrit. According to Prakrit grammarians, Maharashtri is the Prakrit par excellence. It is a language of kavyas or epic poems, such as the Ravanavaha, also known as Setubandha, from no later than the 6th century AD. Maharashtri is also the language of lyrics in Rajashekara's Karpura Manjari, belonging to probably 9th century AD, the only extant drama written completely in Prakrit, and of verses recited by women in the classical drama of Kalidasa and his successors though not earlier. The literary dialect used for conversation among higher personages other than the king and his captains in the drama is Saurasena, while Magadhi is used by lower personages. The language of the early Jaina canon, the final version of which was made in the 5th or 6th century AD, is called Ardhamagadhi. Jaina also used another literary dialect called Jaina Maharashtra for non-canonical works. The oldest poetic work in this is Vimala Suri's Paumacharya, belonging to 3rd century AD. Of the Prakrit dialects mentioned by grammarians, Paishachi or Bhutabhash, both meaning language of demons, is noteworthy. It is said to be the language of the original Brihatkatha of Gunadhyaya, source of the Sanskrit book of stories Katha Sarit Sagara. Buddhist works were also written using a language that has been called Buddhist hybrid Sanskrit. Among these works is the Mahavatsu, the core of which is thought to date from the 2nd century BC. This language is a Middle Indo-Aryan dialect of indeterminate origin, which steadily became Sanskritized in prose sections of later works. The most advanced stage of Middle Indo-Aryan, that is Apabhramsha, was also used as a literary language. That there was literary creation in Apabhramsha by the 6th century is clear from an inscription of King Dharasena II of Vallabhi, in which the king praised his father as being adept in Sanskrit, Prakrit and Apabhramsha compositions. Moreover, in the fourth act of Kalidasa's drama Vikramorvashiya, there are Apabhramsha verses. Because Kalidasa probably lived in the 3rd or 4th century, literary composition in Apabhramsha is earlier still, if these verses are legitimate. There is a great deal of later literature in Apabhramsha, for the most part in Jaina works. For example, Paumacharya of Swayambhu, 8th or 9th century, Hariomsha Purana of Pushpadanta, 10th century, Sanat Kumaracharya of Haribhadra of 12th century. So these are some of the texts available in Middle Indo-Aryan languages. Now we take a look at the linguistic developments. Middle Indo-Aryan is characterized generally by the reduction of the complexities seen in Old Indo-Aryan. The vowel system was reduced by the merger of R and L sounds with vowels and the change of the diphthongs I and O to the vowel sounds A and O. For example, Pali, Acha Sanskrit Riksha means beer, Ina is Rina in Sanskrit depth, Uju is straight Sanskrit Ruju, Puchhati is asks in Sanskrit Prichhati, Metti is Maitri in Sanskrit friendship, it means Orasa means legitimate, it is actually in Sanskrit Aurasa. So moreover, Aya and Ava suffixes commonly contracted to A and O. For example, Pali, Yeti or Jeti conquers in Sanskrit Jayati. Vodhi means limit, in Sanskrit it is Avodhi. Final consonants were deleted with the exception of M, which developed to an Anuswara or M sound, before which a vowel was shortened. In Pali it is Bhariyam and in Sanskrit Bhariyam. Together with the trend toward replacing variable consonant stems by unchanging stems in A, this change had serious consequences for the grammar. Consonant stems steadily disappeared and were transformed to stems ending in a vowel. For example, Sanskrit Sharad, autumn, Sarit, stream, and Sarpis is butter, correspond to polyforms Sharada, Sarita, Sappi. Consonant clusters were also modified in Middle Indo-Aryan. For example, Pali, Ketta, means field, corresponds to Sanskrit Kshetra. The Kshina in Pali means south or right, is from Sanskrit Dakshina. Similarly, Agni, which means fire in Pali, is actually Agni in Sanskrit. Further, Punna means full, is Sanskrit Purna, and Tanha means thirst, in Sanskrit it is Trishna. The shortening of vowels before modified consonant clusters led to the use of short A and O sounds, which were unknown in Old Indo-Aryan. For instance, Pali Semha means flame. In Sanskrit, it is Shleshma, Shleshman. Similarly, Ottha means lip. In Sanskrit, Ostha is lips. The above phenomenon are not restricted to Pali, they are pan-Middle Indo-Aryan. Differences between Pali and Ashokan and other Prakars include the retention of voiceless stops, that is Pathaka, between vowels in Pali and Ashokan dialects. Other Middle Indo-Aryan dialects modify them. The extreme development appears in literary Maharashtri, in which unaspirated stops other than retroflexes and labials were deleted. Aspirated stops were replaced by ha, retroflexes became voiced, and labials were replaced by va. For example, loa word is from Sanskrit loka, loana I is in Sanskrit lochana, saha, which means branch, is actually Sanskrit sakha, padhai recites, reads, is from Sanskrit padati, and savaha, curse, in Sanskrit shapatha. Essentially, on the same level are the dialects of Jaina texts, but in these, a ya glide prescribed by grammarians occurs when a consonant is elided. Vayana is face, Sanskrit vandana. Sayala, whole, in Sanskrit sakala. In Saurseni, on the other hand, voiceless stops pataka between vowels change to voiced ones badaga respectively. For instance, ido, hence, in Sanskrit itaha. Tadha, thus, in Sanskrit tatha. Though Pali and Ashokan are at an earlier level of development with respect to these changes, they share with the rest of the Middle Indo-Aryan dialects the replacement of voiced aspirated sounds between vowels by ha. Lahu in Pali means light, unimportant. In Sanskrit, it is laghu. Dahati gives Sanskrit dadhati. Similarly, they share the change of the to ya, for instance. Jyoti, light, brilliance. In Pali, jyotati shines, Sanskrit dyotati. Pali and Ashokan, however, retain a ya sound, change to ya or ja in most other prakars. For example, the pronoun ya, feminine ya, as in Sanskrit, opposed to ya. The deletion of stop consonants noted above resulted in vowel sequences within words that were unknown in Old Indo-Aryan. Similarly, the extent of Sandhi modification was restricted in Middle Indo-Aryan. The Middle Indo-Aryan vowels E and U do not change to E and V before dissimilar vowels in compounds. For example, Maharashtri, Ratri Andha, dark of night. For example, Ratri Andha Andhaka. In addition, the first of two contiguous vowels in different words is subject to deletion. For example, Pali, Manasichasi, from Manasa Ichasi, you wish in your mind. Now we look at some of the grammatical features. In this grammatical system, Middle Indo-Aryan also reduced complexities. The dual number no longer exists as a separate category. For Sanskrit, Dwabhyam by two, Middle Indo-Aryan as has Dohi, with the ending Dohim equivalent to the instrumental plural Bhis of Old Indo-Aryan. Among other changes is the replacement of the dative case by the genitive, except in particular usages. For example, the use of forms corresponding to the Old Indo-Aryan dative to denote a purpose. In Middle Indo-Aryan, nominal and pronominal forms are no longer strictly segregated. For example, Ashokan, Vijitam hi, that is in the kingdom, also Vijite, has a pronominal ending equivalent to Sanskrit smin. In the verb system, the contrast between active, that is ti ending forms, and medio passive, te endings was obliterated. Further, the old Indo-Aryan distinction between aorist, imperfect, and perfect forms was eliminated. With a few exceptions, the sigmatic aorist, that is an aorist form with sir, provides the only productive preterite of early Middle Indo-Aryan. Ashokan, Nikhamisu, they set out, for instance, actually in Sanskrit, Nirakramishur. In later Prakrits, verbally infected preterites were generally eliminated. In their place was used the past participle. For example, in Saurasaini, Devi, Uvavisa, Maharavo, we are ado, Sidon, my queen, the king has also arrived. Here, for instance, the past participle ado in Sanskrit is agataha, agrees with the direct object, and the agent is denoted by an instrumental form. In Jain Maharashtra, Tenavi Savam Sittham, he has told everything. Tena by him denotes the agent, and Sittham told, actually in Sanskrit it is Shishtam, agrees with the neuter singular form Savam. Sanskrit it is Sarvam. When no object is denoted, the verb is in the neuter singular. Old Indo-Aryan used both the participial construction and the finite verb. Thus, in Prakrit, so vitena savam go, he also went with him, could correspond to Sanskrit sopitena saha gamat or sopitena saha gamat. So both are possible. The Middle Indo-Aryan development eliminated the latter. Alternations of the Sanskrit types asmi, smas were eliminated in Middle Indo-Aryan. The predominant type of present tense was formed from an unchanging vowel stem, for example, yeti, enti, etc. Normal forms of the verb system are of the same type as Old Indo-Aryan. For example, the Pali future tense, future passive participle, katabha, actually the Sanskrit formation is kartavya, to be done, Saurasaini, karaniya, Ardhamagadhi, Jain Maharashtri, and Maharashtri, karaniya, to be done. The infinitive is commonly formed on the present tense stem, not on the root, as in Old Indo-Aryan. Thus, Pali Papotum is formed on the present Papoti. Sanskrit Praptum is formed on the root Prap, present tense Prapnoti. Dialects, Middle Indo-Aryan shows evidence of dialect differentiation or dialectal differentiation. The earliest documents that allow one to determine roughly the dialect distribution are Ashoka's inscriptions. These represent three major dialect areas: east, as in the inscriptions of Jaugada, Dhauli and Kalsi; west, in Girnar; and northwest, in Mansehra and Shahbazgarhi. Characteristic of the east dialect was the final A corresponding to O in the west and S in Sanskrit. In the eastern dialect area, L also regularly corresponds to R of the west and of Sanskrit. Moreover, in the east dialect areas, there is a tendency to insert a vowel within consonant clusters, while in the west and northwest, one of the consonants is assimilated to the latter, to the other, without an intervening vowel. For example, Sanskrit Rajnes of the king corresponds to Girnar Ranyo, Shahbazgarhi Ranyo without gemination, Jaugada Lajine. Northwest stands apart in retaining three spirent sounds, sh, 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 sa, which merge to sa elsewhere. Ashoka's eastern dialect from the Magadha country shows an sa sound for old Indo-Aryan sa, sh, sh, rather than the sha sound typical of literary Magadhi. That is, an alveolar sound is found rather than the palatal sound which is found in literary Magadhi. Grammatical features also show dialectal variation. For example, the Ashokan dative singular form is aye in the western dialects Girnar Athaya for the purpose of, but aye in the east, for instance, Kalsi, Dhauli, Athaye. Apabhramsha. As noted above, the most advanced form of Middle Indo-Aryan is seen in Apabhramsha. Sound changes that are typical of Apabhramsha include the replacement of the vowel sound by U in final syllable. For example, Karahu, you do or make, corresponds to Karaha or Karadha in other Prakrits. From stems in Aya, develop forms in Au and nasalize Au. For instance, Bhadarau, honored one or king, Prakrit Bhattarayo, and Hau means I, Ashokan Hukam. Nasalization also appears in environments in which earlier M occurred between vowels. For example, Gaon, village, from Grama, or Gama. Gama is in Prakrit and Sanskrit Grama. Numerous other sound changes are evident. Among them, the development of S, either geminated, non-geminated, between vowels into her. So Taho, of him, from Prakrit Tassa. In Sanskrit, the same thing would be Tasya. Similarly, Hohinti will be, the Pali form is Hossati. Apabhramsha contractions such as Aya changing to A, Iya changing to E foreshadow New Indo-Aryan in which the development was extended. For example, Apabhramsha, Paniyu, water, Old Indo-Aryan, Paniyam, but in Gujarati, Pani, and Hindi, Pani. In other points, Apabhramsha also presaged New Indo-Aryan. The interest of Apabhramsha lies in the fact that contracted forms presage the New Indo-Aryan opposition of masculine, neuter, and feminine nouns. Thus, Apabhramsha, au, au with nasalized e, Gujarati, o, u, e, for instance, gayo, gayu, gayi, that means went. Hindi, only two, a and e, gaya and gayi. Case system of Apabhramsha is also at a more advanced level of disintegration than that of earlier Middle Indo-Aryan, with the instrumental and locative plurals being identical in form. For instance, ahi or yehi for a stems, and instrumental singular forms also being used as locatives. In the Apabhramsha verb system, present tense stems in a predominate. Apabhramsha verb endings differ from those of other Prakrits. Most interesting is the third person plural type karahi, they do, which coexists with karanti. The form karahi, corresponding to the third person singular karai, he does, is formed on the model of the pair karau, first person singular I do, and karahu, first person plural we do. Here again, Apabhramsha comes close to New Indo-Aryan. Moreover, Apabhramsha has some causative formation that do not occur elsewhere in Middle Indo-Aryan but are known from New Indo-Aryan. For instance, Bhamada causes to turn, Gujarati Bhamare, Bhamare Che causes to turn around, and Pasiarai causes to enter, Gujarati Pesare Che causes to enter or to penetrate. Also noteworthy are two syntactic usages that closely parallel New Indo-Aryan. The present participle is used as a conditional. For example, Jai hau mi tena sahu tau karanto to kim asamahiye sahu marantu. Even if I had performed, that is karanto, ascetic acts with him, would I have died without mental concentration, in which the participles karanto and maranto have conditional value. In Sanskrit, the conditionals akarishyam and amarishyam are used. But in Gujarati, one would say jo hun karat to marat. And Hindi would have the forms karta marta. The Apabhramsha gerundu in ivya, ivva, or evva can be used as an infinitive. For example, piyave lagga, began to drink. This is a Gujarati construction, piva lagyo, began to drink, in which piva is an inflected form of plural pivu, a verbal noun, infinitive corresponding etymologically to the Apabhramsha gerundu. Middle Indo-Aryan shows similar evidence of the influence of linguistically more advanced vernaculars on literary compositions. The Prakrits of elegant literary compositions must have been artificial, different in many respects from the vernaculars current at the time, though reflecting languages that were current at some former time. The Old and Middle Indo-Aryan stages then present a picture of concurrent vernaculars with dialects and literary languages influenced by the vernaculars. It is impossible to compartmentalize the different stages as beginning and ending at any definite time. Lastly, sources of vocabulary in Middle Indo-Aryan. The literary languages borrowed from the earlier literary languages. So here we have Prakritisms, and other types are found. Then we have Deshiyas, and the languages were enriched by the Desha, the local languages also. So there are many sources of for borrowing in these languages. We look at them in the next module. So to summarize, Middle Indo-Aryan is naturally the intermediate stage between Old Indo-Aryan and New Indo-Aryan, New or Modern Indo-Aryan. So Middle Indo-Aryan already indicates various changes. In fact, it shows the direction of change, and it presages what happens in Modern Indo-Aryan. So what you have studied here will take you further to understand what happens in New Indo-Aryan. After all, New Indo-Aryan is the stage where we are now. That takes us more to the present. So there are various texts available. One can study both in the text in the book forum as well as in the internet. Thank you.